Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Somewhere You Feel Free, Tom Petty and Los Angeles, by Christopher McKittrick, narrated by Gary Bennett. Prologue. Who knows where they are from? After claiming in interviews during the Heartbreakers' 40th anniversary tour that it would be his band's last full-scale tour, Tom Petty departed the stage of the Hollywood Bowl on September 25, 2017, the final show of the five-month celebration of the band's incredible history. Mike Campbell, the Heartbreakers' lead guitarist and bandmate of Petty's since they were both 20 years old, was doubtful, telling Rolling Stone in a June 2017 story presciently titled Inside Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers' Last Big Tour, "I've been hearing that for 15 years. We'll see." It certainly wasn't the first time that Petty had talked about scaling back the band's touring schedule. But this being another false declaration, or a cynical marketing ploy, seemed less likely than before. For one, Petty was finally starting to look his age, moving across and off the stage that night with a noticeable limp. The 66-year-old bandleader was not known for being particularly acrobatic on stage since the Heartbreakers' late 1970s run to superstardom, but footage from the Hollywood Bowl concerts shows a Petty whose performances are every bit as powerful, if not more reserved in movement. Still, like Campbell, the Los Angeles audience had reason to doubt Petty's words about the finality of touring, particularly on the Heartbreakers' home turf. Even when touring Europe, Petty never seemed far from Southern California. Most of the Heartbreaker tours either began or ended at venues not far from Petty's Malibu home, and almost half of the dates played on Petty's previous tour with Mudcrutch, his Before He Was Famous band that he revived in 2008, had been in the Golden State. Many of Petty's older musical heroes, like Bob Dylan and Byrds bassist Chris Hillman, whose album Bide in My Time was produced by Petty and released on September 22nd, the day of the second of Petty's three Hollywood Bowl concerts, still maintained active touring schedules. In fact, shortly after the Heartbreakers ceased serving as Dylan's backup band in October 1987, Dylan embarked on a touring cycle critics and fans have dubbed the Never-Ending Tour. By Dylan's standard, the Heartbreakers were practically in semi-retirement already. Sadly, that third Hollywood Bowl show was indeed the final concert by Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers. Petty died at the UCLA Medical Center in Santa Monica, California, on October 2, 2017, the consequence of an accidental overdose of pain medication he had been prescribed, in part to treat knee and hip issues that plagued him before and during that final tour. At a cursory glance, an artist with the voice of Tom Petty, both in terms of his artistic voice and the unmistakable Northern Florida inflection in his vocals, seems like an odd fit for Los Angeles, especially when one has the erroneous point of view that the Heartbreakers' music falls under the umbrella of Southern rock, or, even more off-base, whatever critics mean by the label Heartland Rock. When Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers released their self-titled first album on November 6, 1976, nobody quite knew what to make of them. The Los Angeles-based band didn't fit comfortably in any of the categories of music popular in 1976. Petty certainly didn't look or sound like a hard rocker, and the band didn't sound like punk, even if they were a bunch of skinny 20-somethings in casual dress and leather jackets. Their songs certainly weren't disco or arena rock or anything that involved prominent synthesizers. Nonetheless, the Billboard review of their debut album dismissed Petty, on one hand, as another punk rock, black leather jacketed offshoot, while on the other stating that the album gains impact on its second spin. In the opening line of his review of the album for Rolling Stone, famed rock critic Dave Marsh asked, "Who knows where they are from?" He went on to say in his short comments that no part is particularly special. Songs, singing, playing are all kind of primordial LS rock, like Love or The Seeds. Still, he followed that lukewarm criticism with an extremely prophetic line, "But it's such a 60s throwback, you can't help but fall in love." It demonstrated that the only people who really thought of the Heartbreakers as punk didn't actually listen to the record. The desire of the establishment to put any label other than rock and roll on the Heartbreakers' music makes it no surprise that Petty, in the cover story of the November 1977 edition of Backdoor Man magazine, declared the oft-repeated line, "Call me a punk and I'll fucking cut you." It even became the article's subtitle. Petty continued, "I'm fucking serious. I don't fuck around. From the beginning, I think because I have a leather jacket on the album sleeve, they called me a punk. Don't fucking call me one. I don't like that. I ain't joining nobody's club. I've got my own club. I'm in a rock and roll band." Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers was released by independent label Shelter Records and distributed by ABC Records, which by then was in the first stages of being on its last legs. The label would be sold to MCA Records in 1979, leading to the first of Petty's many battles with record labels. As a result, the album received little promotion stateside. The Heartbreakers were not a magic combination that instantly unlocked music industry success for Petty. The band's 1976 debut was mostly overlooked. In contrast, Petty's stablemate on Shelter, Dwight Twilley, had a top 20 hit with his band's debut single, I'm on Fire, which peaked at number 16 in August 1975, before the Dwight Twilley band had even recorded an album. The Heartbreakers didn't have the same luck. Of the singles from the self-titled debut album, only Breakdown charted in the U.S., crawling to number 40 in February 1978. That nominally gave the group its first U.S. top 40 hit, but it utilized every bit of industry clout that ABC's vice president of album promotion, John Scott, had in a Herculean effort. The album wasn't certified as a gold record by the Recording Industry of America until January 1988, almost a dozen years after it was released. Yet, just a few years later, more people would have heard the Dwight Twilley Band's Phil Seymour singing background vocals on Breakdown and American Girl than on any Dwight Twilley Band album. That Petty and the Heartbreakers survived and later thrived is doubly impressive, viewing their collective accomplishments through the changing face of Los Angeles and the entertainment industry as a whole. One doesn't need much of a deep dive on Tom Petty to realize that Los Angeles is the only place that could have produced a musician like him and a band like the Heartbreakers, which was formed from the remnants of Petty's Gainesville band, Mudcrutch. Los Angeles had molded Petty before he and fellow Mudcrutch member Danny Roberts and roadie Keith McAllister crossed the Florida state line on their way to Hollywood in pursuit of a record deal in 1974. Petty's childhood in Gainesville, Florida, has been extensively documented, often focusing on his difficult relationship with his father, his teenage years playing in a variety of successful local cover bands, and his crowning youthful achievement of establishing Mudcrutch, the locally famous band that drew hundreds to its music festival-like performances at the farm where the band crashed, affectionately called the Mudcrutch Farm. While Petty was shaped by his early years in northern Florida, he was also molded by the mid-century pop culture that he consumed. Born at the dawn of the 1950s, Petty was a child of the television age. In an interview for Petty, the biography, Petty recalled being enchanted by the idealism of Los Angeles at an early age. "What I did come to notice was that everything really great seemed to be coming from California," remembered Petty. The television announcers would say, "From Television City in Hollywood, it's the Red Skelton Show." And I thought, Television City? Man, that's where I need to be. This is when I was still a little kid. Television turned me on to a whole different idea of living, and I was a sponge. But pretty soon you start wondering if there isn't something between what you see on television and the shit you're dealing with at home. He also said, "I knew I didn't want to grow up and be an insurance salesman. That looked really dull to me. And I think it was television that saved my life, that raised and educated me." Petty also developed a deep love for movies, especially older ones from the golden age of Hollywood. In later life, he claimed to have watched 3 or 4 movies a day, and while touring, preferred staying in hotels that offered the Turner Classic Movies channel on their televisions. It seems incredibly appropriate, then, that Petty's first of many encounters with a rock and roll icon happened not through a jukebox or at a concert, but on a movie set. While those early glimpses of Hollywood on television had grabbed Petty's interest, Petty was really bitten by the entertainment bug in one of the most mythological ways possible, by meeting Elvis Presley on a movie set when Petty was 10 years old, as if to push fact into an even more unbelievable territory that rock and roll legend occupies. The title of the movie Elvis was filming was 1962's Follow That Dream. "I've always thought it was a cosmic title," Petty would later say in conversations with Tom Petty. How the preteen Petty came to encounter the king of rock and roll seems like a setup to a Hollywood screenplay. Petty's uncle, Earl Jernigan, regularly helped scout locations for filmmakers working in Florida. Jernigan had scouted the courthouse in Ocala, Florida, about 40 miles south of Petty's hometown of Gainesville, for a scene in Elvis's movie. Jernigan's wife, Petty's Aunt Kitty, asked the boy if he'd like to go on a trip to meet Elvis, and Petty went without really knowing who Elvis was. Whenever an impressive-looking man walked by, Petty asked his aunt if that was Elvis. Finally, the man himself appeared. In a piece Petty wrote for Esquire decades later, he recounted of that moment. "When I met Elvis, we really didn't have a conversation. I was introduced by my uncle, and he sort of grunted my way. What stays with me is the whole scene. I'd never seen a real mob scene before. I was really young and impressionable. Elvis really did look, he looked sort of not real, as if he were glowing. He was astounding, even spiritual." With this combined taste of rock stardom and Hollywood, Petty saw his future. Shortly thereafter, he traded his Whammo slingshot for a box of Elvis 45s. 3 years later, Petty would receive another cosmic nudge when he saw the Beatles make their American debut on The Ed Sullivan Show and realized that if he could get a few guys from the neighborhood together to play in a band, they could be rock stars like the four young men on television. That was when the world turned to color from black and white. All of a sudden, Technicolor, Petty said in an interview with Billboard in 2005. "I was 13 or 14, and knew exactly what I wanted to do with my life, no question. It still baffles me a little bit as to why the lightning bolt hit me, but it did." Once Petty was firmly entrenched in the Gainesville music scene, Los Angeles became even more of a draw to him, as it was the place where fellow local musicians with substantial talent had gone to find their fortunes. The 1960s and early 1970s Gainesville scene, which revolved around the University of Florida, proved to be remarkably fertile. Stephen Stills may have taken a roundabout way to get there, but both Buffalo Springfield and Crosby, Stills, and Nash were formed in Los Angeles. Bernie Leadon had become a member of the Flying Burrito Brothers and a founding member of the Eagles in Los Angeles. Even Tom Leadon, 2 years Petty's junior and a one-time member of Mudcrutch, had made it to Los Angeles and was playing in Linda Ronstadt's band. These musicians spent years cutting their teeth in Gainesville and were now writing and performing hit records. It was all Petty wanted, and he knew that to do it, he too would have to go to Los Angeles. Ironically, but not surprisingly considering the well-documented crooked history of the entertainment industry and the music industry in particular, Los Angeles record labels became both the key to Petty's music dreams and one of his biggest obstacles. He had several well-known major battles with the music industry, some of which became first paragraph mentions in his obituaries. Famously, he declared bankruptcy to get out of his first record contract, later went on to battle with his label when they wanted to release his 1981 album Hard Promises with a premium price tag, and even released a single to radio about how disappointing radio had become under expanding corporate ownership. He was an agent of change that fought against rising concert ticket prices and lamented the direction of MTV, a channel whose popularity he helped develop with his imaginative music videos. But he also had other pet peeves with the industry that clearly bothered a man whose public image seemed to be laid back and carefree. The same supposedly laid-back man who declared, "Call me a punk and I'll cut you." Whatever the public thought of Petty based on the image he portrayed on stage, in music videos, and in interviews, those who knew him best never considered him laid back. as he confessed in conversations with Tom Petty. My kids have this huge laugh about me. I just spent some time with them, and they were laughing about my image. They said, "The world pictures you as this laid-back, laconic kind of person, and actually you're the most intense, neurotic person we've ever met." That's kind of true. You're not always what people picture you as. One of those peeves that Petty certainly wasn't laid back about was a long-running dispute he had with the Los Angeles Times for not ranking the Heartbreakers highly on a 1988 list titled LA's Greatest Rock and Roll Band, Who Is It? In Petty's recollection, which he shared in an interview with the Los Angeles Times in 2014, the newspaper had erroneously claimed that the Heartbreakers were ineligible because the band had formed in Florida. He took particular umbrage with the list because the lead singer of the band ranked number one, Jim Morrison of The Doors, was also from Florida. In Petty's estimation, points were being unfairly deducted from his band. However, Petty's recollection wasn't entirely accurate. The Heartbreakers were indeed included on that 1988 list, but the band had been ranked eighth between Little Feat and Love. While Petty and nearly all of the original Heartbreakers hailed from Florida, the exception being bassist Ron Blair, a Navy brat born in San Diego who later lived in Gainesville, the Heartbreakers did not form until 1976 at the Village Recording Studio in West Los Angeles. And though Petty and the Heartbreakers pianist Ben Montench and guitarist Mike Campbell had also played in Mudcrutch in Florida, in Petty's estimation, the Heartbreakers was a separate band entirely from Mudcrutch, and, thus, a child of the Los Angeles music scene. But the Heartbreakers understood that their lack of Van Halen flash may have been held against them in the late 70s and early 80s Los Angeles music scene. As Tench carped to BAM magazine back in 1978, "You're only an LA band if you go and hang out on the strip a lot, and make a big deal of pointing out to people that you hang out on the strip a lot. We're not into that." Petty certainly considered the Heartbreakers' place in music firmly within the California rock tradition. "I think maybe if we were gone, God forbid, there would be a different take on us," he said in a 2006 interview with Rolling Stone, "because this group is really the last link to that whole California thing, to the Byrds, Buffalo Springfield, and that whole era of music that came along. This is probably the last thing that attaches to that." In the same period, he spoke about the unfairness in conversations, adding, "We love the Byrds, and we love the Beach Boys, and Buffalo Springfield and the Burrito Brothers, and we kind of felt we belonged here in L.A., and we always have, though we're still never referred to as an L.A. band. We're always referred to as a Southern band. But the truth is, every bit of music we've ever made was in L.A. We've been in L.A. for over 30 years. We're a Los Angeles band." By that time, there were few people left who would argue against Petty's assessment. In 2010, Petty expressed his disappointment directly to the Los Angeles Times that his group was often left out of these assessments. "I think we're really Californians. I've been in California longer than I was in Florida. Certainly, where you grow up is always going to be deeply embedded in your soul. I don't know, but sometimes it kind of hurts my feelings that we're not included in discussions of Southern California music. The Heartbreakers formed here. We really are an LA band." While the Los Angeles media and some rock critics might have initially excluded Petty and the Heartbreakers from the Southern California rock pantheon, area fans embraced Petty as a Los Angeles icon. Chapter 1. There's Something Happening Here. The modern recording history of Los Angeles began in 1942 with the founding of Capitol Records by songwriters Johnny Mercer and Buddy DeSilva, along with Glenn Wallace, owner of famed record store chain Wallace Music City, whose flagship store was in Hollywood. Capitol's original offices were located upstairs in the Wallace Music City building. While recording studios and small record labels had existed in Los Angeles prior to Capitol Records, the company headquarters, which remains an iconic part of the Hollywood skyline, came to symbolize the shift of the music industry's base from New York City to Los Angeles. Each of the three men entered the partnership with considerable success. While Mercer had yet to pen In the Cool, Cool, Cool of the Evening, Moon River, or Summer Wind, and had not yet won the first of his 4 Academy Awards for Best Original Song. By that time, he was already an established songwriter who had moved from New York City to Hollywood the previous decade to write songs for RKO Studios. His credits include what could be considered the anthem of Tinseltown, Hooray for Hollywood, which appeared in the 1937 Warner Brothers film Hollywood Hotel. Buddy De Silva, 15 years Mercer's senior, had also been a celebrated New York City songwriter who had worked with iconic figures like Al Jolson, George Gershwin, and Lou Brown before heading to Hollywood to produce films. At the time of the founding of Capitol Records, he was an executive producer at Paramount Pictures. Wallach's Music Store was known for popularizing several record store innovations, such as sealing records in cellophane, placing records in waist-high bins that made browsing them easier for customers, and listening booths. On the retail level, Wallach's understood how to sell records better than just about anyone else in the United States. By the 1940s, Hollywood had long been the home of the film industry, and in spite of the popularity of popular music and film since Al Jolson introduced the sound era in 1927's The Jazz Singer, there are no major record labels based in Los Angeles. With their backgrounds, Mercer, De Silva, and Wallach's recognized the potential that a major record company could have in the entertainment capital of the world. Capitol Records ended up a runaway success, and the three men's gambit paid off. By 1955, Capitol Records was one of the industry's heavyweights and was acquired by British record company EMI for $8.5 million. Shortly thereafter, EMI began construction on the Capitol Records building in Hollywood that would later be dubbed the Sound Capital of the World because of the famed studio's prominence in popular music. The circular building and its 151-foot spire became an instantly recognizable landmark of Hollywood. Similar to how the film industry gradually moved much of its operations from New York City to Los Angeles from 1910 to 1930, the 1940s and 1950s saw a rapid increase in record labels of all sizes planting roots in Los Angeles. Many of the labels had corporate ties to the major film studios. American Decca Records, which bought into Universal Pictures in 1945, took full control of Universal Pictures in 1952, creating a powerhouse media company. Decca and MCA would merge in 1962 to create an even larger company. MGM would establish MGM Records in 1946, and Disney established Disney Music Group in 1956. United Artists would establish its own United Artists Records in 1957. Warner Brothers Records was established in Burbank in 1958, and 20th Century Fox Records was established the same year. The rapid expansion didn't stop there. Even Motown, a label distinctly associated with Detroit, would move much of its operations to Los Angeles by 1972. In addition to these conglomerates, the Los Angeles landscape became dotted with dozens of independent record labels and recording studios. The proliferation of labels, studios, and performance spaces led to young musicians heading to Los Angeles to make it. By the mid-1960s, Los Angeles had birthed a music scene that would produce famous groups like the Byrds, the Mamas and the Papas, the Doors, and Buffalo Springfield, as well as a burgeoning club scene in the area of what became known as the Sunset Strip in Hollywood, later West Hollywood, that would host decades of rock stars on its stages. All of these venues soon learned that by catering to popular musicians' every need, on stage, off stage, or in studio, they could count on repeat business from repeat clientele. In late 1966, the Sunset Strip area became subject to strict regulations, including a 10 o'clock p.m. curfew on the clubs, after locals complained that the district had been a haven for youth drinking, drug use, loitering, and noise. To protest the curfew, organizers called for a rally at Pandora's Box, a popular club located at the corner of Sunset Boulevard and Crescent Heights Boulevard that was owned by KRLA disc jockey and later Shindig host Jimmy O'Neill for the evening of Saturday, November 12, 1966. Pandora's Box had become the prime target for locals, even though it did not serve alcohol on its premises. That initial protest which reportedly attracted about 1,000 demonstrators, kicked off several weeks of unrest in the area that resulted in dozens of arrests and were later dubbed the Sunset Strip Riots. In the aftermath of the first few weeks of almost nightly demonstrations, the Los Angeles City Council purchased Pandora's Box with the intention of closing and demolishing it, which it did the following year. In those weeks, the demonstrations had already begun to be mythologized in the media. Buffalo Springfield recorded, "For what it's worth, Stop, Hey, What's That Sound?" in early December 1966 as a narrative of the demonstrations, and it was released before the end of the year. Stills performed the song for the first time publicly on Christmas Day 1966 on the stage of the reopened Pandora's Box during its final night of operations. For What It's Worth would soon become a top 10 hit and the counterculture anthem of the late 60s. Showing their understanding of Southern California music history, the Heartbreakers regularly covered the song during their 1987 U.S. tour, and Petty performed it alongside members of Buffalo Springfield after his speech inducting the band into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 1997. March 1967 saw the release of Riot on Sunset Strip, a low-budget exploitation movie released by B-movie distributor American International Pictures, featuring the title song performed by Los Angeles garage band legends The Standals, best known for their hit Dirty Water, which the Heartbreakers would also cover a handful of times decades later. Though significantly embellished, the film did help to add to the idea of Hollywood being a haven for counterculture musicians. In fact, Riot on Sunset Strip was one of the first of several low-budget exploitation films released in the late 60s to depict hippie culture. Yet even those who contributed to the myth of the Sunset Strip riots admitted that the name was a result of media hype, with Stephen Stills telling the Los Angeles Times in 2007, "Riot is a ridiculous name. It was a funeral for Pandora's Box, but it looked like a revolution." Indeed, it became clear that the Sunset Strip riots became just one of the growing number of youth counterculture protest movements that would go hand in hand with pop music culture for the rest of the decade. The soon-to-be iconic Rainbow Bar and Grill opened in April 1972, and the Roxy Theater opened in September 1973, as the Los Angeles music scene in the early 70s shifted from the famous Laurel Canyon sound and psychedelic rock of the Byrds, Buffalo Springfield, The Doors, and Love, as represented by Pandora's Box and the Whisky a Go-Go, and gave way to singer-songwriters like Neil Diamond, James Taylor, Carly Simon, Joni Mitchell, and Randy Newman, who all helped establish the Los Angeles club Troubadour as one of the country's premier music venues. Though many of those musicians were very much in the same tradition as, and contemporaries of, the Byrds and Crosby, Stills, and Nash, by the mid-70s, much of what represented the late 60s in California rock was gone, or had moved on, in the wake of the Manson family murders in Southern California, and the disastrous Altamont Speedway Free Festival in Northern California, both in the latter half of 1969. Buffalo Springfield, The Doors, The Byrds, and The Mamas and the Papas had broken up due to deaths or infighting. Crosby, Stills, Nash, and Young were on hiatus after touring arenas and stadiums in 1974, while the Eagles had their first number one album with 1974's One of These Nights, and were well on their way to becoming rock and roll powerhouses with the addition of Joe Walsh and the release of their greatest hits and Hotel California. Even the Beach Boys, who served as influential predecessors to the entire Los Angeles scene, were rapidly establishing their position as America's favorite nostalgia band with the 1974 release of the Endless Summer compilation and its 1975 follow-up, Spirit of America. The vocal-driven, folk-psychedelic rock combination that had marked the era had all but vanished, leaving Elektra Asylum Records artists like Jackson Browne, Linda Ronstadt, and Warren Zevon as the remaining products of the movement. This was the world that Petty, Roberts, and McAllister entered when they arrived in Los Angeles in 1974 with Mud Crutch's demo in hand. They had left Gainesville with a list of addresses for record companies taken out of Rolling Stone. The band, at the time consisting of Petty, Campbell, Tench, Roberts, guitars and vocals, and Randall Marsh, drums, having reached their limit in Gainesville, made the decision to head west. Petty first attempted to land a deal with Georgia-based Capricorn Records, home to the Allman Brothers Band. I remember hanging around the studio with the Marshall Tucker Band, who were making their first record and invited us in, and we sat around all day and waited for someone to listen to our tape, he told Mojo in 1999. And the answer was, it's too British. So we decided then we were going to California. Florida wasn't the place for us. We'd done everything we could do there. We had a huge following. We could do 1,000 people. But it wasn't going anywhere. Petty elaborated on the decision when discussing the period in Conversations. We realized we were just on a merry-go-round, that we would just keep playing the same bars and the same thing and not really get anywhere. So that's when California came into the picture. Because Bernie Leadon had gone to California and had a lot of success and started the Eagles, and he would come home now and then. We'd talk to him. And then Tom Leadon, when he left Mudcrutch, he got a job with Linda Ronstadt playing bass. And that was before she was really happening. But he was going on tour with Linda Ronstadt. We were really impressed, like, wow, you got a gig. Then he got in a group that actually had a hit single in some band named Silver. A completely forgettable single, but it was a hit. That did it. Okay, we're going to California. That's the way it is. We're going to L.A., where the Byrds are. Because the South had become completely inundated with the Allman Brothers. The Allman Brothers had gotten big, and every group had become an imitation of that. Literally everybody but us was an imitation of the Allman Brothers. And they were playing really long songs and jamming, and we hated it. We liked the Allman Brothers, but we hated all the imitations. We thought it was stupid. The often soft-spoken Campbell put it much more succinctly when speaking to BAM magazine in 1978. LA is opportunity. It's where we went to do what we wanted to do but couldn't do in Florida. Prior to leaving, Mudcrutch had sent their demo, which was recorded on a two-track in the Tench family living room, to various record labels and received just one response from Playboy Records' Pete Welding. Welding was a jazz and blues historian who had worked for various record labels throughout the years, often producing albums for obscure artists. He was really respected in the jazz field, and he was A&R for Playboy. He rejected us, but he was nice enough to send us a song-by-song analysis of why he was rejecting us, and what could be better, and what we should work on, Petty said in Conversations. So I took this to be really encouraging, and we drove out to see Pete Welding in L.A. The trio set out for what Petty called the greatest trip of my life, and arrived in the city he'd been dreaming about since before he knew he wanted to be a musician. His first impression confirmed those deeply established feelings. Petty continued speaking about the journey in Conversations, recalling, we drove into Hollywood, and then it seemed really easy to me because we went down Sunset Boulevard, and in those days, there were record companies everywhere. Everywhere you looked, there was a record company. There was MGM Records, and of course there was Capitol. I just thought, well, all we've got to do is go into every one, and we'll get a deal. And we fell in love with L.A. within an hour of being there. We just thought this is heaven. We said, look, everywhere there's people making a living playing music. This is the place. Armed with equal parts determination and naivety, Petty followed through with his direct plan of attack. Arriving at Playboy Records, they found out that Welding was no longer with the label, and the A&R man there wasn't interested after listening to a few seconds of the demo. The short-lived label would fold in 1978. But going from label to label did lead to results. MGM Records offered them the opportunity to record a single, which was a start, but something akin to a consolation prize for a band hoping to make an album. Aside from the story of meeting Elvis, Petty's life doesn't lend as well to the mythologizing aspect of American rock, sometimes self-induced, but oftentimes crafted by rock journalists looking for an iconic hook for a profile they're writing. However, what happened next runs a close second to meeting Elvis in the Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers creation story. The trio knew that there had to be more record labels in Los Angeles than what Rolling Stone had listed, and while eating at a diner on Sunset Boulevard, Petty stepped out to find a phone booth to look up record labels in the phone book. After finding a booth, Petty discovered that a list of 20 record labels, complete with phone numbers and addresses, had been dropped on the ground. While finding a list of record company addresses at the exact moment one is looking for it seems like a gift from the rock and roll gods, Petty recognized the downside, that someone else, and perhaps even hundreds of other hopefuls, were on the same quixotic mission he was. One of the companies on the list was Shelter Records, which was located in a nondescript bungalow in a rough section of East Hollywood. In 1978, BAM magazine described the building as resembling the Symbionese Liberation Army safe house, where Field Marshal Sing Q and his soldiers were barbecued by LA's crack SWAT team a few years ago. Certainly the house has little in common with the plush but sterile corporate digs that house most record labels in LA, but it definitely has its own charm. Cream's Stephen Demarest saw the shabby nature of Shelter's offices as what set the label apart when writing about the building in a profile of Petty in the August 1978 issue, remarking, "Shelter Records may have the coolest offices in America, a ramshackle wooden house nestled under a grove of tall trees set well back from Hollywood Boulevard. There's a genuinely rural flavor about it, a substantial earthiness which contrasts the surrounding city of electric lights and sky, Los Angeles, the mirage in the desert. Shelter is not just casual, which is now a designer's term for expensive clothes. It's totally loose." After dropping off a tape at Shelter, the group moved on to the next label. Even better than the single offer from MGM, the trio received an offer from London Records for a one-album recording contract. London, which was owned by the British arm of Decca Records, American Decca being a wholly separate company after a split, was known to Mudcrutch as the original American label of the Rolling Stones. The only condition was that London wanted the band to earn its own money during writing and recording of the album by playing cover gigs, which Mudcrutch had already been doing for years. Nonetheless, Petty, Roberts, and McAllister had accomplished their mission. Now all that remained was to return home conquering heroes and come back to LA with the entire band. While still in Hollywood, the trio took one night to indulge themselves in the scene and realized they were entering a world where playing to hundreds in Gainesville meant absolutely nothing. The group made one stop for pleasure, visiting the Whisky A Go-Go, the famed West Hollywood club that had kickstarted the rock and roll scene in Los Angeles and popularized go-go dancing with Johnny Rivers, Otis Redding, The Byrds, Buffalo Springfield, Janis Joplin, Led Zeppelin, Love, The Mothers of Invention, The Doors, Them, and The Stooges, all having graced the stage. In an interview for Petty, the biography, Roberts remembers, "We were kids from Florida. This was another world. We went to the Whisky because we'd always heard about the club. We go in, get a little booth. Holy shit, and it's rocking. Then I hear a voice near us that sounds familiar. I listen for a few minutes, and then, finally, I have to get up and look over this little divider between the booths. It was Ringo Starr, Harry Nilsson, and Jesse Ed Davis. It was the only night we went out in Hollywood. And if that happens, I mean, do you think we wanted to go back to Gainesville to do anything more than pack our stuff?" As it turned out, less than 4 years later, Petty would be performing on the Whisky's stage with a band that didn't include Roberts. Appropriately, band legend has it that Mudcrutch left Florida for Los Angeles on April Fool's Day, 1974. But plans changed. Though Mudcrutch had the intention of leaving Florida to record an album for London, a phone call led to an abrupt shift in destination. Denny Cordell, the Argentinian-born English producer behind the biggest hits of the Moody Blues, Procol Harum, and Joe Cocker, and co-owner of Shelter Records with famed pianist and songwriter Leon Russell, called after listening to the demo dropped off at the Shelter office in Hollywood and suggested that before committing to London, the Mudcrutch caravan make a detour to Tulsa, Oklahoma, where Oklahoma-born Russell had built a studio in an old church. Cordell would meet the group there, and they would feel each other out. The proposal worked. Shortly after meeting Cordell in a Tulsa diner, Mudcrutch agreed to sign with Shelter and continued on to Los Angeles to prepare for recording. Of course, what felt like a dream at first would turn sour years later. Or, as Petty said during a live broadcast of his Buried Treasure radio show in 2011, "I came to LA and got a record deal the first week, and it took me years to get out of it. Accompanying Petty on the cross-country drive was his new wife, Jane, whom he married shortly before leaving Florida. She had been Petty's girlfriend for about a year. Shortly after arriving in Los Angeles, Tom and Jane learned they were going to become parents. Their first daughter, Adria, was born in November 1974. Once Mudcrutch arrived in Los Angeles and signed their deal with Shelter, the band was put up in the Hollywood Premier Motel, a nondescript motel located on Hollywood Boulevard, a block east of Western Avenue, which was not far from Shelter's office. The band evenly split the $10,000 advance given to them and spent much of their time hanging around Shelter to absorb the atmosphere. In fact, the band wasn't pushed to start recording right away. Petty told Billboard in 2005, "They really nurtured us along for a good year or so before Cordell even let us make a record." The band later left the motel and settled into two houses in the San Fernando Valley, north of Hollywood. A significant part of that nurturing involved Cordell introducing Petty to new music, taking him far beyond whatever he could previously find on the radio and in the record stores in Gainesville. "He was my guru," said Petty in the liner notes of Playback. "I would go to his house in Malibu every Sunday, and every day when the end of the workday came, I would sit in his office and out would come the records. The office was closed, and we'd sit there until 8 or 9 o'clock, and he'd play me everything in the world. Just everything. Lloyd Price, reggae stuff, Rolling Stones, everything that had ever turned him on, or me. We'd bring them in. I'm forever indebted to Denny Cordell, because we couldn't afford that many records. We were so hungry to hear everything. In Gainesville, you could only hear what you owned, and we didn't have enough money to have stacks of albums, so running into somebody who had just unlimited access to records was incredible. It was just a bonanza of information." Future Heartbreakers drummer Stan Lynch had a similar view of Cordell's influence. "He taught me a lot, sometimes in very abstract ways," he told Modern Drummer in 2008. "I was still young and I didn't really understand what he meant by groove and feel. I remember asking Denny, 'What does that mean? Can you quantify that?' So he tells me he's taking me to a Bob Marley and the Wailers gig, and he flips me the keys to his Ferrari. As we're driving, he's making me haul ass, and he says, 'Stanley, driving a Ferrari fast, that's what a groove feels like.' At the gig, Marley had the place hypnotized. Someone's passing a joint through the balcony, and Denny says, 'That's what a feel is.' He was just being helpful in his very 70s way, saying, 'These are the things that feel incredibly good, that can't be duplicated. You'll know it when you know it.' Sure enough, we went back to the studio and we got 2 tracks that night. I was so vibed." Another part of that nurturing involved getting the band into studios to feel themselves out. The first mention of Mudcrutch in Billboard appeared on August 31st, 1974. At the Village Recorder in Los Angeles, Mudcrutch is in with Denny Cordell producing and Rick Heenan engineering. The band's name wouldn't have meant anything to most readers located outside of Florida at that time, including readers in the band's new hometown. But the Village Recorder was well known as a West Los Angeles recording studio converted from a Masonic temple in the late 1960s. The Village would play an important role in the formation of Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers, but this wasn't quite it yet. A second mention came in the November 16th edition of Billboard, stating that Mudcrutch was recording at Producer's Workshop with Cordell producing and Galen Senegal's engineering. Producer's Workshop was another 1960s Los Angeles studio that had started to attract big-name talent in the early 1970s. About the same time Mudcrutch was recording there, Carly Simon was recording Hotcakes, and Ringo Starr was recording Goodnight Vienna with a parade of special guests. Mudcrutch's sessions were nowhere near as fruitful. The change of scenery appeared to do little to help the band with recording, and they returned to Village Records to record and mix a single. In a 2016 interview with Uncut, Campbell bluntly said, "We weren't any good in a studio. When we got out to California and started really trying to record, either self-consciousness or just incompetence set in, and we sounded like hell." Tench agreed. "We didn't sound like us. We sounded better in my parents' living room with a 2-track recorder. At one point, the band even tried recording covers to take them back to their bar band roots, but nothing seemed to click. The sessions did produce a single, the reggae-influenced Depot Street, backed by the more radio-friendly Wild Eyes. Cordell, who was fully on board with the reggae craze since before his label released Bob Marley's first American single in 1971, suggested to Petty that he write a reggae song. Cordell thought it was the strongest song from the session and put it out as a single. The idea wasn't so far-fetched. Eric Clapton's cover of Bob Marley's I Shot the Sheriff went to the top of the U.S. charts in 1974. The single didn't receive significant airplay, didn't sell, didn't chart, and didn't amount to anything outside of a short review in the February 15, 1975 edition of Billboard in its First Time Around column for new artists deserving of exposure. The review calls the song a good reggae cut that fits in with the current commercial standards as well. Closest thing to actual reggae to have a chance to be a major AM hit to come along in some time. That forecast was wildly off the mark. Just months after the euphoric high from signing a contract, Mudcrutch emerged from the studio feeling woefully unprepared, and worse, having nothing but a dud single to show for it. All the while, Mudcrutch had been lying low in the burgeoning Los Angeles rock scene that would soon launch groups like Van Halen and the Runaways to national success. By the mid-70s, the live Los Angeles rock scene had roared back with a completely different sound than what had graced the club stages only 3 or 4 years prior. Several rock bands that had developed followings but didn't have albums were regularly playing both the Whisky and the Starwood, including the Runaways and Van Halen, who had played at both venues several times before the release of their debut albums. The Sunset Strip scene had been heating back up with punk and new wave bands, many of them being played on Pasadena-based FM station KROQ, which relaunched in August 1976 with Rodney Bingenheimer as a Sunday night disc jockey. In spite of its massive success and huge influence, KROQ was operating on a shoestring budget in early 1976 after it relaunched following a 2-year absence from the radio dial, in a desperate attempt by its owner, concert promoter Ken Roberts, to retain the station's license. Roberts was only in an ownership position as a consequence of previous station ownership not being able to pay him for a Sly and the Family Stone concert at the Los Angeles Coliseum the station had sponsored. Roberts later bought out the other owners and embraced the punk and new wave format. And by 1978, famed KROQ program director Rick Carroll continued to emphasize upcoming artists while mixing enough top 40 music into the rotation to make the station appealing to audiences all over Los Angeles. Being based at the heart of the music industry only made airplay on KROQ all the more valuable to emerging artists. Bingenheimer soon became known for breaking many bands, even playing bands' demos on the air, making his show, Rodney on the Rock, a must-listen program for music fans in the area. The station soon became the dominant rock station in Los Angeles for punk and new wave music. But the growth of that scene had little impact on Petty at the time, since his music didn't fit into either of those categories. Furthermore, Mudcrutch was nowhere to be seen on Los Angeles club stages. Another blow hit the band when Danny Roberts announced he was leaving the band and returning to Florida shortly after Mudcrutch performed at the 1974 Shelter Records Christmas party. Stories regarding the reasoning behind Roberts' departure conflict depending on who tells the story, but the basic truth is that the man whose van Petty rode in on the fateful cross-country trip was no longer part of the group. To replace Roberts on bass and vocals, Mudcrutch recruited Charlie Souza, who, at 2 years older than Petty, had been a veteran of the regionally popular mid-1960s Tampa-area rock band The Tropics. The Tropics had appeared on American Bandstand and seemed to have just missed the opportunity of reaching national fame when the music of the 60s counterculture rendered them relics before they really had their chance. Souza, who had returned to playing bars in Florida with a new band, seized the opportunity. In a 2016 interview with Uncut, Souza recalls his initial impression of the current state of Mudcrutch, remembering, "Tom picked me up at LAX. He was waiting for me at that gate. Just him. I got in his little Opel sports car, threw my bass in the back, and we started riding up the 405 and down into the valley. That was an experience. We bonded and he wanted me in the band. Eventually, I found myself over at Shelter Records on Sunset Boulevard, looking up at the Hollywood sign, thinking to myself, Well, this is it. I'm on top of the world now. Unfortunately, that moment was arguably the height of Sousa's short-lived experience with Mudcrutch. By that time, the band had stopped wasting Shelter's money on studio sessions that weren't producing results. Petty had been asked by Shelter to house-sit for Leon Russell, and in return, Mudcrutch could use the studio at his house. According to Sousa, the sessions at Russell's Encino home, and a brief return to the studio in Tulsa, were a period of 4 or 5 months where nothing was really happening, and we just kept recording stuff. I would listen to what Tom would play on the piano and sing, then I'd put a bass part on it. The sessions weren't a total loss. One song the band recorded was the original demo of Don't Do Me Like That, a song the future Heartbreakers in the room didn't know would become the band's first top 10 hit before the end of the decade. Petty had written it on a piano at Alley Studios, rendered as Alley, A-L-L-3-Y, on the sign, located on Lancashire Boulevard in North Hollywood. I didn't have a piano, Petty remembered in conversations, but in my head I could hear that rhythm, the piano playing that right-hand part, ding, 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 ding. It was only about $8 an hour. It wasn't much money to rent a studio, but it was the loneliest feeling, walking in there by myself, sitting there and playing the piano. Though Petty described Alley as kind of dingy, the studio has a celebrated history as a rehearsal space for dozens of artists, including the Eagles, the Red Hot Chili Peppers, the Black Crows, Jackson Brown, Stone Temple Pilots, and many others. Among the many signatures that adorn the brick walls of the space is that of Thomas Petty. Petty also wrote and recorded Hometown Blues at Russell's house, which ended up on the first Heartbreakers record with Randall Marsh on drums, Charlie Sousa on saxophone, and legendary Booker T and the MG's Donald Duck Dunn playing bass. Those bright spots, however, weren't enough to keep the enterprise going. Cordell called Petty to his office to tell him he was cutting his losses and dropping the band. Still, Cordell saw potential in Petty and decided to keep him under a $6,000 a year Shelter contract as a solo artist. Petty managed to talk Cordell into retaining Campbell as well, but it was left to Petty to relay the bad news to the rest of the band. In the aftermath, the Pettys moved to the Winona Motel on Hollywood Boulevard, just 3 blocks east of the Hollywood premiere, which forced Tom and Jane to make a major life change. He recalled,
"We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description."